So Giovanni did his PhD at Kiel University in Germany in the power electronics group, and he finished that in 2018. And then he did a short postdoc also at Kiel University. And in 2019, he moved to the Institute for Technical Physics at the Karlsruhe Institute of Technology, where he's leading, I believe, both two groups actually, the real-time system integration group and also the power hardware in the loop lab. And in addition, last year in 2020, he was also awarded a Helmholtz Young Investigator Group for a project entitled Hybrid Networks, a Multimodal Design for the Future Energy System. So yeah, it's my pleasure to introduce Giovanni, and now I'll hand the floor over to him for his talk.
Okay, thank you so much for the nice introduction. And I'm going to share my slides. So I believe that you, a moment. Okay, so I believe that now you can see the full screen. Please confirm that.
Yes,
yeah, it works.
The full screen, yeah.
Okay, perfect. Thank you so much. So today I'm going to present actually our work that we are pursuing in our group, but also our collaboration at KIT level, investigating energy futures, the Energy Lab 2.0 and Enkara collaboration at KIT. So this presentation actually is divided in four different parts, where in the beginning I'll focus on the methodology that we are currently developing at the Energy Lab 2.0 on how to develop digital twin experimentally. So I will introduce this new approach that we are trying to pursue. In particular, I will give you during this talk two possible applicative examples. The first one is a microgas turbine, and the second one, the high-speed flywheel. After two examples, I will actually give you an overview of our activity between the Energy Lab 2.0 and Enkara, in particular, developing of digital twins of large research infrastructure, such as particle accelerators. But then let's go in order. You know that currently in the energy systems, there are many new technologies that are available. Every year, we have a different solution that is integrated in the market and that aims to solve specific problems. However, it comes always the real question: how can we realistically analyze the performance of these new energy solutions? These are solutions that are not yet fully integrated in the field, so we don't have this kind of experience that we have maybe with synchronous generators or that we have with older devices that are ready in the grid for 20, 30, 100 years. So what can we do actually to prove one of these new solutions? Well, the problem is that usually what we can do, we can prove it with a simulation. However, the problem when we go for a simulation is that usually we have always to fight between the accuracy of the model and its computational time. We may decide to go for fuel models that give us a comprehensive vision of the object, but however, this can be computationally too heavy. This is a particular problem when we wanted to model it with the real-time systems, where we are actually limited from real-time constraints, hard real-time constraints. Of course, we can actually linearize this model, we can do some assumption, or eventually we can also get rid for certain level of any dynamics using steady-state models. However, every time that we do this kind of assumption, we know that we are going to lose a bit of information. So basically what we expect to be a model, comprehensive model, is a model that works only for specific cases. So in order to tackle this problem, what we are proposing at Energy Lab 2.0 is to develop experimentally digital twins. So what we do in this case? We take our resource. Let me take maybe the laser point. We have our own resource, okay? Here you can see, for example, a flywheel. We see a Mercurius turbine that I'm going to present you later, or you see like the accelerator CARA at the KIT. What we do here? We install an extensive measurement unit so that this real-time model actually can be realized by means of measured data of the field. Whenever we have measured data, actually, we don't limit actually the model to, let's say, an open loop validation. That means I have the data, I create my model, and that's it. No, what we perform is an experimental validation in our power around the loop lab. So what we do, we reproduce several conditions of the grid, and we see how the model reacts with respect to the real hardware that we have in the lab. And then we try to understand also the extent of our accuracy of the model. As third step, actually, we take that model and we apply control actions, then we can help us to verify actually how the model works with respect to the real hardware. And we feedback this information to our model in order to update our modelization, basically our model itself. So basically what we have at the end, that when we apply this kind of process in iterative way, we will have an experimentally validated digital twin that will be valid within a certain dynamic spectrum. And this is valid to address specific grid problems. Let's make a practical example to explain this concept. Here, for example, you see the microgas turbine that we have in our lab. This is a rather complex device, despite being relatively small, because actually we have here our gas turbine, we have our cooling system, the gas supply. What we do actually in this case? We want to perform, first of all, a detailed mechanical, thermal, and electrical model. Then we are going to optimize the model for real-time execution. We validate the real-time execution by means of power around the loop. And then we validate, so out of this validation, actually, we achieve the microgas turbine digital twin. How to do that? Well, the first thing that we have to do is to define the dynamics that we are interested in. Okay, so in this case, we have to identify the interested energy carriers and dynamic. For example, we want to model only the thermal aspect of the turbine, or we want to model both thermal and electrical aspect. So when we determine that, we define the physical differential equations. So we write actually the mathematics behind it. Once we have these differential equations written on the paper, we have to translate them in the numerical form. So something that our simulator are able to understand and that are able also to read in a simple way. Because what happens? In the same moment that we have a numerical form, we can use solvers to find the numerical solution of the new set of differential equations. Why is it so important? Because once you have also the numerical solution of the problem, you avoid that the simulator actually must do for you during the simulation. So actually, we give directly the solution to the machine. In this way, the simulator is able to carry the model to actually to run the model in much faster way. Well, what you do is then, in a further step, to compare the model with commercial software that is not been optimized for real time, and we compare which is the execution time script versus the commercial software. Well, we did some simulation of it, comparing actually the script that we have developed and the model, a more detailed model that we have developed in MATLAB Simulink. Well, what we can see from this slide, actually, the script that we developed and the mathematical model in Simulink, so with the real components of Simulink that with the components that you can find in the SimPower system library, is matching with the minimal error. We are talking an error that is much lower than 1%. What is the advantage in doing that? That in the same moment that we go to compute the simulation time, and so to compare it from the Simulink model here and the script model realized by my colleague, actually we can achieve up a factor 29. So it means that the new script can run in a real-time machine with a factor that is around 30 times faster than the model realized in Simulink. Not only that, but if the machine, the simulator allows, we can actually decompose it in more cores, achieving a much stronger acceleration factor. Well, once we have realized our model and we know that this model runs faster, the other point that we have to do is to validate experimentally with the gas turbine that we have in the lab. Here you see that the experimental proof together with the simulated model of the electrical and the thermal power that we have achieved the two experiments. What we have done here? Actually, we have simplified our model in this case, and we have tried two different approaches with linear and nonlinear transfer functions using the method that I described to you before. Well, basically, then we were able to compare the real experimental validation with the simulated models, and then we could actually understand if the model is able to represent carefully the experimental results or no. In particular, you can see that using a nonlinear model helps us to reproduce more carefully the behavior, the nonlinear behavior of the microgas turbine, while a linear transfer function shows some limitation in the representation of the transient. This is important and can be done only by means of experimental validation. Another example that I would like to introduce you in this moment is the one done with our high-speed flywheel. The problem is, so we had actually a problem when we had at the beginning this flywheel. How can we build a model that is accurate enough and at the same time it can run also in this case in our real-time machine? The problem was that in this case the flywheel is a commercial device on the opposite of the microgas turbine, where we had more possibility to actually modify the setup in order to measure different kind of values. Well, in a commercial object, you don't have many possibilities actually to open the box and see what you have inside. So this problem, actually, we try to address it in three different ways. The first one, actually, we thought, okay, We can try to search in literature. We can try to use the manual, the data sheet of the flywheel, and perform accurate software simulations with one of the many software that you see here. The advantage is that doing that is we have a flexible and without risk environment. Nothing can burn because we are in simulation. And we can change actually the testing environment as many times we want. The problem is we have some problems here in terms of reliability, because we don't know if we are able to model all the phenomena or all the devices that are included in this flywheel. Okay, so the other possibility that we envisage at the beginning is to perform actual field tests. So we take the flywheel, we connect it to the grid, and we let it run. Well, for sure, that gives us the highest fidelity. So it's the real object in the real grid, and actually we can see what does it do. The real problem is that we have to wait, for example, that the frequency of the grid goes down or up in the way that we can actually see some changes in terms of flywheel power. That is really time consuming. And in some cases, if you consider that you need to have an engineer working always there, is also costly. And also it does not give you any flexibility in changing the testing field. So the alternative to that actually is the power around the loop testing. That actually is a technique that is relatively new, developed in the last 15-20 years, that combines actually the software simulation and the actual field test advantages, being able to be flexible and low risk, because you can change the testing condition, and at the same time gives you high fidelity and gives you the possibility to repeat the experiments as many times as you want. Well, it's too good to be true. So how does it work really, the power in the loop? The power in the loop actually is composed of two main parts, or better, sorry, the three main parts. The first one is the real-time simulator. In the real-time simulator is actually this kind of computer where I simulate a grid and I let it run a grid with relatively small time step. Usually we are in the range between 10 and 50 microseconds. The second object that is important for the power in the loop is the power amplifier groups. So in this case, what are these power amplifier? These are power converters. We have in the lab power converters up to 1 megawatt total power. That works a sort of translator of a digital signal that comes from the real-time simulated grid and the real power signal that they give in the output. So if here, for example, the voltage is 230 volt, I see here the voltage in the output 230 volt, but this is a real power signal. Why do we need that? Because then we can connect here the object under test, for example, our flywheel that we are interested in. And actually this object under test will do its job following any change that the grid will have in its simulation run. So the voltage changes here, the amplifier applies a voltage change here, and our hardware under test react to that voltage change. When this hardware under test react to the voltage change, there is a current change, and the current is then fed back to the real-time simulated grid, where it is represented with a simple current source. So you see, here you have actually a loop. So if we have a real-time, if you have a change in the real-time simulation, we see it on the hardware, and when the hardware reacts, actually the real-time simulation sees the effect of that reaction. basically what I'm going to show you in the next couple of slides is that we are going to use the power around the loop system to validate the digital twin of our flywheel system. How does it is composed actually the power around the loop setup for testing this flywheel energy storage system? Well, first of all, what we need is the flywheel itself. So the flywheel itself is commercial, is from the company Stornetic, that is a company in Germany, that is actually the one that you see here in the figure. Then this commercial flywheel is actually connected to the one of the 5 200 kilowatt power amplifier that we have in our lab. Then what we do? This power amplifier feeds power to the flywheel. We measure the current and we send the measurement back to the Opal real-time simulator that we have in our lab. Here in our simulator, you see, we can, depending on the test that we want to perform, actually use simpler grids or more complex grids. Eventually, we can also use the Opal real-time simulator to implement some standard protocol communication protocols in order to communicate with the commercial hardware. So what did we do? Well, the first thing that we did was to realize a simulation of a model of our flywheel energy storage system. So my colleague, Shab Carrari, actually built this model, modeling the grid side converter, machine side converter, flywheel, all the controllers of it. And then the other point that is really important in this case is that with an experimental validation, we can actually include the losses and auxiliary power requirements. Why that? Because you see, when you have a real hardware, you don't have only the losses of the device. So you don't have only the losses, for example, of the converter or losses of the machine, but you have also some losses that are actually the auxiliary power requirements. In the case of flywheel, for example, we have the losses and auxiliary power are composed by speed dependent losses that are the losses that are actually in the iron of the permanent magnet synchronous machine of the flywheel. Current dependent losses that are actually the copper losses in the whole conversion system. And then the auxiliary losses that are basically that kind of losses that you have that allows you the converter and the permanent magnet machine to work. An example, the air conditioning system, the vacuum pump, the electronics, all the safety checks, safety controller that you have. So these are small things that at the end, they can have an impact on the actually on the performance of the machine itself. So basically what my colleague did is to take this model, to include this also this modeling of the losses in the model itself, and then to validate it experimentally. Basically, how to do that? He went in the power around the loop in our simulator, and he represented a phenomena that has already occurred 2 years ago now, in the August 9th of 2018. That is a large frequency change in UK. So my colleague took the simulator, implemented actually this large frequency change, and basically began to compare the model that he developed and the real hardware performance. Okay. Basically, what he found out, that when we see the power and the flywheel state of charge, the model that has been developed, including also the auxiliary losses, actually has an error that you can see here that is extremely small. Basically, in the highest point, so the maximum error was less than 1%. So basically, in this way, we were able to validate experimentally in a realistic grid condition the digital twin of our flywheel energy storage system. Well, what can we do actually with this validated model? What we can do is that we can apply also some control actions and see actually if how the flywheel can behave in a more realistic condition, like for example the high landing of a small microgrid. Well, basically, what my colleague also performed in this case, that he took this digital twin. In the digital twin, actually, he applied different kind of controllers, some controllers from literature and a controller that he developed itself, and actually validated them with a real-time simulation, and then he reproduced it also in experiment. Basically, what we achieved, what we saw, that in our case, of course, our controller worked better with respect to the literature. That was the main goal of this publication. But actually, we noticed no difference between the results achieved in simulation and the results that we achieved with the real hardware. Now, we come to the last part of this presentation, and how can we actually transfer this kind of experience that we had with the microgas turbine and with the flywheel when we talk about much larger and complex infrastructures, like for example, the particle accelerator. Let me give you a moment, a background about it. So why did we choose a particle accelerator? The reason is really simple, because actually particle accelerator, you imagine, I don't know, the CERN, or in Germany we have a DESI, FAIR, we have the BEST in Berlin, are devices that range in the tens or hundreds megawatt of power. And they get bigger and bigger. So that means that actually the energy efficiency is a really important factor, because actually among all the 100 units of energy that you give to the particle accelerator, only few units or percentage of units arrive up to the beam. So, and not only that, actually, the real problem is that accelerators actually are extremely sensitive to grid power quality. So we can risk that for any small voltage change, we may bring it to a loss of experiment, and we want to avoid that. So for that reason, we actually merged our knowledge and our expertise with the particle accelerator CARA and the accelerator technology platform at Caltech to develop, to begin to think about new energy solutions for particle accelerator in the way that they may work in the future, more CO2 neutral, so more green, and at the same time, they're able to work in weak grid condition, so where the grid power quality is not guaranteed. How to do that? Well, first of all, we need our experimental benchmark. That is important. We need our hardware under test. That in this case is the particle accelerator CARA. As you can see here, this is the power consumption, or better, the energy consumption of CARA of every hour. You see that the power profile of this accelerator is let's say, not constant among the day, because there is mostly in the central hour, there is an higher power request. And in the central days of the week is a higher power request. And during the night or the weekend, or during the period where there is some maintenance work, actually the power drops from 10 megawatt up to a couple of megawatt, 3-4 megawatt maximum. So you see that we have actually cycling of power among the week, and we have also cycling of the power intraday. And that is also something that is dependent on the external temperature. So you see that when we talk about a particle accelerator, we have a system that is strongly multi-physic. So it does not matter only the electrical side. So basically, we took this as our experimental benchmark. And the first thing that we did was actually to equip it with an advanced measurement system and communication infrastructure. So what do we do in this case? We need to sample data. In order to sample data, we are equipping currently now the all the different strategic points of CARA with voltage and current measurement unit, together with the groundwater cooling system that is currently under construction, and the solar power, photovoltaic power park. And actually all these points communicate with a master controller that samples all these measurement and transfer it in real time to the Energy Lab 2.0. The interesting point of this measurement system is the sampling frequency. We are actually working in a range between 10 and 20 kilohertz. So we are able to actually measure and transfer data to Energy Lab basically in real time. Currently, we are trying to measure the latency of this communication infrastructure, and the first results will come in the next couple of months. Then, when the data arrives in the Energy Lab, we actually send it to our real-time simulator, where actually is in communication with the CARA. And in this case, we are going to build here our digital twin of the particle accelerator. When we have here our digital twin, actually, what we can do? We can take, for example, our flywheel, and through the power in the loop all, we can actually test a new energy solution with the digital twin of CARA without actually affecting the real hardware. In that way, we can show, for example, the flywheel can solve the power quality problem or the fast power fluctuation of an accelerator. And then, when we are sure that it works with the digital twin, we can actually propose this as an energy solution for the accelerator. How to do that? So how we can develop, in this case, a digital twin of particle accelerator? You can imagine that is not really simple, because actually when we take our infrastructure, when we try to model it, also by using data-driven models, we have still something that is extremely complex. Well, our goal, that is what we are targeting to do in the next couple of years, is to use data-driven models and then to optimize them in order to let them run in real time. So the next step of our work will be actually to take these models, and as we did for the microgas turbine, to have something that are able to let a huge experimental facility run in a model, in a real-time model. So that when we implement it, then we can also feedback control action to the real facility. Here, for example, as the last slide that I already mentioned to you before, is what we are planning to do as last step, that once we have the CARA digital twin, we can actually prove any technology, that energy technology that we want to prove for accelerator in our lab. In this case, I mentioned you a flywheel, but actually we will be able soon to prove a 500 kilowatt supercapacitor energy storage system and also an hydrogen-based energy storage park. So this was my presentation about the contribution of KIT in terms of real-time digital twins. And now I would like to receive also from you some comments or question about this topic. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you very much, Giovanni. It was a very interesting talk, fusing both these simulations and these experiments that you have in the lab to model these larger scale experiments. So now we're open to questions from the audience. So just feel free to raise your hand or just unmute yourselves. Anything is fine. And while we maybe wait for those questions, I mean, it's not really my field, but I have kind of a general question myself. Mm-hmm. So obviously much of what you do is about validating your theoretical models with this loop in the lab experiment and power in the loop, sorry. So I was wondering, I mean, with your models, I guess, as you mentioned at the start, it's necessary to make some kind of simplifications. But I wonder if also you ever compare with kind of higher fidelity, more accurate but more expensive models, just as a kind of an alternative comparison tool, as well as validating with the experiments.
Yes, so actually here you have actually two ways to validate any kind of model. So as you mentioned, either with a more complex model or you can directly follow the experiments. Actually here we prefer to do with experiments for a simple reason. First of all, because also the most accurate model actually depends, is always depending on the spectrum of dynamics that you want to cover. It's extremely difficult actually to realize a model that covers all the spectrum of dynamics or non-linearities. So this is the advantage to use the real hardware. Also, here you mentioned also why you do such a kind of simplification or assumption. The reason is that having a digital twin that runs in real time gives you actually the possibility to validate your model with the same input that you have with your hardware. So for example, if I go here, let me take a more general picture here. And for example, here I have the hardware that I wanted to model. Now, I can send here in the input of power amplifier the signal, the real signal that becomes the power signal to the hardware, but I can use the same signal to be sent to a real-time simulator, okay, to your model itself. So actually, you can validate in real time, in parallel, if your model actually respects what the hardware is doing. And that is the main advantage, because also is important in some cases, the reaction time of the model itself. Because for example, some models require some external input from a measurement unit. For example, in the power system, it's common to have input from fault relay, or from now it's really used the phasor measurement unit. So if you wanted to have some more complex system, more complex testing setup, actually you can do it only if you run in real time.
Okay. Yeah, that makes sense. I don't at the moment see other questions from the audience. Maybe another quick follow-up from me. When you when you kind of construct these linearized models or these more simple models, is your approach usually something that's like physically motivated? So you make certain assumptions and then you kind of look at it from a kind of physical perspective and see what can be missed out, or do you use a kind of more data-driven approach and just try and, I don't know, train a network just to look for a linear relationship?
Actually, we are trying both kind of these solutions. So for example, here in the gas turbine, in this case, we actually worked with a black box model. So a transfer function or linear transfer function that can represent this kind of behavior. But actually, we are trying to work also with white or gray box models, where we can represent totally or partially the real system equation and adapt the parameter of them. Of course, that depends always what you want to represent, which kind of phenomena wants to represent. Because if you work with the constants that are, so time constants that are relatively long, you may work directly with black box models. So where, for example, you cannot take in account non-linearities in a simple way. Instead, when you want to have faster dynamics or more attention to the non-linearities, you need the white or gray box models. And this is what we do currently now, using equivalent models for the microgas turbine in order to find a more comprehensive, a more systematic description of the behavior of the gas turbine.
Yeah, that's similar to some of the approaches we try to use in our group. So I still don't see any questions. Yeah, it was a really great talk. Thanks very much for giving it. Very interesting and very clear, even for me, who's not from the field. So I'll hand back now to Philip to continue the discussion.
Okay, thank you for inviting me.